Welcome, everyone, to this very special evening, I think. Not only is this the lecture that is organized because it's the fourth anniversary of the Center for Contemporary European Philosophy, but also because Hartmut Rosa is here, a world-famous, world-renowned sociologist, one of whose books has just been published in the Dutch language. Living in times of acceleration, leven in tijden van versnelling. And we are very honored to have him here. We also decided to start with the screening of a short film. You've just seen Typewriter Head by Eric Giesmann, a German, so that's fitting. It's about the acceleration, the rush that the Typewriter Head figure is also struggling with, maybe because we don't exactly know where we are going to. It turns out that this Typewriter Head person finds some sort of heaven, maybe. We might be finding places of resonance as well. We are going to talk about that with Hartmut Rosa later on. He will join a discussion with a philosopher of technology from the Radboud University, Peter Lemmens. So he'll join me, I'm Lisa Doeland, programmer at Radboud Reflects, in a discussion, at the end of which we'll give you, the audience, all the time to discuss, ask questions, etc. But first, I would like to ask Professor Jean-Pierre Wiels, a philosopher and theologian at the Radboud University, and also a member of the Center for Contemporary European Philosophy, to give a proper introduction of Hartmut Rosa. Thank you.
So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We saw a brilliant small film. I think it was the best introduction possible to the lecture of this evening. I think so. Some aspects of the film seems to be very familiar to my life as a professor at the university. So it's not alien to my own experience, what we saw here this evening. So welcome to this anniversary of the Center for Contemporary European Philosophy. So one of our favorite topics is modernity contested, the contested aspects of modernity. I mean, we all know that we are living in contested times now, in difficult and uneasy times. So we need people who are able to offer us a kind of convincing diagnosis and even perhaps a perspective about change and about the possibilities of an alternative life to these conditions. So I mean, the best, one of the really best scholars we could have invited is Hartmut Rosa, of course. So he's one of my favorites, I have to admit. And I know his works since years, and I admire what he is doing. There are few sociologists with philosophical ambition, so he's one of the very few of them. And it's really nice listening to what he's saying. So there are even less philosophers with sociological ambition. So I think that philosophers can learn a lot about the times they are living in and about their interpretations, listening to people like Hartmut Rosa. So this evening he will speak to us about living in times of acceleration. It's an aspect of a theory of modernity and linked to our living conditions now. So he is a professor of sociology at the University of Jena in Eastern Germany, and is the director of the Max Weber College in Erfurt as well. I think a lot of his books are translated now in English, even in Dutch one is translated. Leven in tijden van versnelling, een pleidooi voor resonantie. I'm sure you will enjoy this lecture, and I don't take any time now from the time we are offering him. So please, the floor is to you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre Wiels, for this kind introduction, and to Lisa and oh yeah, I need this, and everyone else for the invitation. It's a great pleasure for me to be here. It's my first time in Nijmegen. And but actually I heard quite many good things about it, so I was really curious. I am still curious to see what it's like, and so far it's quite kind to me, even though the weather wasn't as I wanted it to be, of course. All right, so yes, what I want to tell you about is, Jean-Pierre Wills already mentioned it, it's about, it's a theory of modernity, really. I'm strongly convinced that we need both sociology and we need sociology and we need philosophy to understand our predicament, the society we live in, right? I believe that's what we, and of course we can only do it in jointly, in talking together. I even believe having events like this is a part of doing science. It's not just that we, the scientists, tell you what we found out. I think it's a kind of, it's an exchange, it's a way of doing science, that we come up with ideas, at least we try to interpret the world on the basis of data and theories and other things, and then we get into dialogue and see whether it works out and where it fits and where it does not fit. So I want to make an attempt about what our society, how we can interpret modernity and our society and our life, and what maybe is wrong with it and what we could do about it. So I want to, at first I really want to give you a kind of story and an illustration of what I think modernity or modernization as a process is really about, what's happening to our planet. And then I want to define it more clearly, structurally. I think we can define a modern society as a society that can only stabilize itself dynamically, which means that we permanently need to grow, to speed up, and to come up with innovations in order to stay as we are, right? To keep our jobs, to keep the welfare system, to even keep the political system. In order to keep what we are and who we are, we need to increase in speed, for example. But I believe there's also a cultural side to this, and that's what I want to do in the third step. I call this now the triple A strategy to the good life, right? Because I believe even if you have a structural system like capitalist modernity, there needs to be a motivational force, this logic of acceleration, dynamization. It's not falling from the sky or is in the institutions by itself. If you want to call it capitalism, that's fine with me. I think there's a lot of truth to that. But capitalism is not just out there in the structures. I believe it's inside us because it's forming subjects, and I want to find out how. And that's, of course, where we need philosophy about our definition of the good life. And then the fourth step, I want to tell you why I think that this program is at the verge of breaking down, or at least it's not leading to the good life, but it comes with a lot of problems. Structurally, it leads to desynchronization, like ecological problems, political problems. And culturally, it leads to alienation, to a frustrating life, which I think the signs, the symptoms of this we see in politics, but we also see in what we could call the burnout crisis. So this will be the fourth step. And then in order to not end on too pessimistic a note, I want to tell you how we get out of this. Because I have actually just, in Germany, particularly Germany, but also in France and in many other places, I presented my theory of social acceleration as a actually quite critical theory of modernity. And mostly people said, yes, I think that's plausible. That's how I experience life too. So tell me what to do. And then I always said, well, I'm a sociologist, right? I don't know what to do. I'm not a politician or a prophet or something of that sort. But then people said, so why do we pay you? Because we already knew that we are in trouble. Then somehow I take it to be more a media effect that people thought, well, Hartmut Rosa is propagating deceleration, slow down, right? Slowness. And I always say that I never did that, right? I was really surprised. I think it was a very simple logic. If speed is a problem, then slowness must be the solution. And I think that is actually wrong, right? For two reasons. One is we cannot, if my account of dynamic stabilization is correct, that we live in a society that needs to speed up in order to stay what it is, particularly because it's capitalist, then we cannot just leave society as it is and just slow down, right? That would just lead to the breakdown of society. But on the other hand, I don't think that slowness per se is an end or a valuable goal in itself. a slow interconnection is just a pain in the is just a pain, okay? And a slow fire engine is really dangerous, and even a slow roller coaster, if it does the looping and it's too slow, it falls down. So slowness certainly is not something desirable in itself. So when people dream of slowness, I believe they have something different in mind, and this is a part of what I want to say in the last step. So now I have already, I need to speed up. Oh, I have to check the watch. Okay, so 5 minutes, okay. So if you, I really find this interesting. I mean, you know, there's a lot of debate about what is modernity about. I mean, we can discuss that forever. And there's a growing number of scientists, sociologists, political scientists, cultural people working in the humanities and philosophers who think, let's no longer talk about modernity. It's too much, it's too grand a concept, right? There's many, there's multiple modernities and so on. And there are many cultural diversities, and there are many reasons to doubt whether there is such a thing as modernity. And I want to insist that we need these kind of macro perspectives. We can then debate about it, where it's true and where not. But if we give it up, we don't really see anything. So my suggestion to you is this: imagine we were aliens, imagine there are aliens, and they are better than the NSA. They have put cameras in space, and they watch the planet, right? They have a kind of surveillance. What are they doing down there? And I really think probably for thousands of years, they wouldn't be alarmed, and they think, well, it's a boring planet, not too much is happening, right? There are certainly people sometimes shifting places also, and the metabolism might increase. But generally, there is not much kinetic energy, not much dynamism in the world. I mean, certainly there are people like Marco Polo, who in the 13th century went to China, but it took him many years to get there. His father did so too, right? But for both of them, it took them many years to get them. It was isolated individuals, and they stayed there for many years. So actually, it's not much dynamics going on there, right? So, and even if a whole people moves, which of course they did, or there's a certain form of nomadism, there is no kind of permanent increase in dynamics. It's just certain controlled movement. I mean, it might be true that the Polynesians or the Vikings had some intercontinental traveling. The Vikings might have discovered America, and the Polynesians maybe also. But generally, things like that were either accidents, it was due to a storm or so, or due to some natural disaster which forced them to go, or at least it was a kind of mostly an isolated incident. But in the 18th century, actually in the 17th century, if the cameras are good, they would see that people tried to move faster, really literally move faster. They wanted to travel at a higher speed, so they tried to straighten the roads, right? No longer follow the streak, which has many bends, but make it straight in order to speed up traveling, and they exchanged the horses before the horse carts more often. Actually, they realized that if you want to travel fast with a horse cart, you should not wait after a day until the horse recovers and sleeps. You just exchange horses when they are tired, right? So you can travel faster. So they started experiments with new sails, new communication forms, without having new technologies. So I think it's very important to see that the new technologies, which then came, like the steam engine, was not the beginning of this. It was an answer already to something which obviously had changed. People wanted to speed up life, and then the cameras would register that now something's going on down there on the planet, right? There are steamships, right? And it's not just that there is one steamship or two, but very soon there were regular lines, right, of ships going back and forth, and the number of ships increased almost permanently. And then there came the railway. At first, only one between Manchester and Liverpool, 30 miles per hour, really, or even below that, quite slow, only one. But then the system increased and increased. More and more tracks, more and more locomotives, faster locomotives than America, than India, South Africa. So apparently, something's going on. Steamships, locomotives, and even something like the bicycle is a modern invention. It's very interesting. We could have invented this many centuries ago, but it was a modern invention, and it indicated that people, even within their small spaces, like Nijmegen or so, they wanted to move faster, right? And they did. So the dynamic energy obviously increased, and then there were people traveling, there were goods, raw materials and goods moving back and forth, and then there came the automobile along. And I'm not so much concerned about the high speed of things, but about the average speed, about the kinetic energy of what's going on there. People in motion, goods in motion, and also things changing, by the way. And then with the automobile, of course, the kinetic energy increased vastly. Think of what that looks like from the outer space. There is something going on down there, which is dramatic. And then with the airplane, you have the next step. And at an age like ours, as we sit here and speak and talk, there will be about 1.5 or maybe even 2 million people up in the air. Right at this very point in time, there are about 1.5 to 2 million people up in the air. So what happens very obviously is a permanent dynamization, material dynamization of the world. And then of course, if they have really good cameras, they would realize that it's not only the goods and the people and the materials going back and forth, but it's also ideas, currencies, finance, images, and that kind of thing. So I think it's kind of impossible to deny that there is a logic of dynamization which characterizes our world since the 18th century in particular, right? So that was the alien point of view. So what we need is, what kind of social structure is it that creates this kind of dynamization or even requires it? And I believe this process of modernization must be driven by some motivational force, which is a psychological force, something that is driving these people down there. And I think if you say it's capitalism, we are the victims or so of a capitalist system, I think this is not convincing for a number of reasons which I cannot I don't want to go into at this point, but I think there must be kind of motivational lures, a promise, which is driving these people. That's what I would think if I was an alien out there. So let's clarify these two moments. Okay, so I want to do this relatively quickly. If you have read the book or heard anything by me, you know it, because I've done it for many years. My claim is I wanted to know systematically what is acceleration or what is dynamization in this sense. What does it describe? And my claim is there are three different dimensions of dynamizing the world. One dimension is what I've just talked about. It's the speeding up, technological acceleration, the speeding up of transport, of communication, but also of production. The Industrial Revolution and the Digital Revolutions are revolutions of speed, doing things much faster than we did it in the past. So technological acceleration is a goal-driven speeding up of or an intentional speeding up of goal-driven purposes. But there is also a change of a different sort, because in this process, society does not stay the same. The rates of change increase. The world around you changes at a faster pace. This has material aspects, right? How often do they exchange chairs in this theater? Would be a good empirical study. Let's check it. Right? How long does a chair like this survive in a theater? Right? I'm pretty sure that you would see that the waves in which they renew the seating and the ceiling and the lights, on average in Dutch theaters, you find a speed up. Right? But that's only one dimension of it. The material world around us changes at a faster rate, but also the patterns of association. Who lives with whom, who works with whom, who interacts in what ways with whom. Our practices, how does one use a cell phone or a computer and things like that, they change at a faster pace. So this is the second dimension. There's an acceleration of social change. And if you live in a world that changes faster and faster, you have to run faster and faster just to stay in place, basically, right? To keep track with the changes. So people accelerate their pace of life, which means we try to condense, to be faster in what we do, right? To get more, to increase the number of episodes of action per unit of time. So I believe since the 18th century, if the aliens are very clever and they observe us as a kind of universal ethnologists, they would see that people systematically try, they feel pressed to act faster, right? Don't waste so much time in whatever you do, right? And of course, all the technology, if you want to understand technology, it's really surprising if you think about it. There's hardly any technology which does not help you to save time, right? The car saves time. Even the hairdryer saves time. Get your hair dry at a faster pace. The cigarette, okay, cigarette is not a technological thing, but it was an acceleration compared to the cigar. And the microwave oven tries to help, or does actually help to save time, and so on. There's virtually no technology which does not intend to help you save time. Okay, so the third dimension is an acceleration of the pace of life. We try to get more things done per unit of time. We do this through acting faster, fast food, power nap, quality time with kids, and so on. There are even drive-through funerals. Or we try to not have any pauses and breaks, so you took the last train to Nijmegen to go to the cinema, and you have probably something scheduled right after it, right? Don't have breaks and pauses and intervals. And you can do multitasking. So if the talk is too boring, you can always write some emails or do some other things. So you get the number of episodes of action you increase in this way, right? So this is through a temporal perspective, this process of dynamization, setting the world in motion and speeding it up materially, socially, and even in the intellectual fabric. I'll come back to this in a second. So this is my definition. So we actually might ask, well, how does this come about? How is this institutionally designed or geared? And this is my definition of a modern society, right? So I think the aliens maybe would look down on Earth. You can always make criticisms of this, but we can discuss it later. So nevertheless, my definition of modernity is this: a society can be called modern when its mode of stabilization is dynamic. That means when it systematically requires acceleration, growth, and innovation, right? Let me say it again. A society or an institution is modern when it systematically requires an increase of some sort, dynamization, you could say, in order to stay the same. Right? So where do we find this? I mean, it's easy to see. Of course, we find it in the economy. You can see this with Marx, but I think you don't have to be a Marxist to see the logic of this formula and also the power of it. The claim is, in a capitalist economy, money in the form of capital is only invested when there is a promise that you get an increased return, some sort of profit or gain or rent. Can discuss that, the differences economically, but it doesn't matter here. The claim is the logic of the economic operation, of economic institutions, of economic activity is geared towards increase. The economy would immediately halt and break down if this logic of making more out of what you invest falls down. So you see why a capitalist economy runs on the logic of dynamic stabilization, right? You have to increase, to grow, and to accelerate the three. Actually, in my book, I brought it under the one term acceleration, but it has these three sides, right? Growth, because acceleration is defined as quantitative growth per unit of time, and it's achieved through permanent innovation, right? So modernity, capitalist economy requires all three in order to sustain itself. But I personally find it really interesting, and that's what I always say, and I argue with my Marxist colleagues in Germany, that it's not just capitalism. I believe it's the logic of modern institutions, even outside the pure logic of capitalism. And I think science is the most interesting field, maybe, where you find exactly the same logic. And I find this really interesting. When we could probably talk the whole evening about this. What is knowledge? I mean, I think those alien ethnologists would, if they have a very good view over centuries or millennia of life on Earth, of human life on Earth, they would probably get to the conception of knowledge, which is like a treasure, because a society, let's call it a society, group of human beings, they need to know how things are done. You need to know how to how to produce your clothes and how to grow the crops or how to hunt the game or the deer or so on, and also how to do the rituals in the temple. So knowledge for even the so-called high cultures, right, is a kind of treasure. And there are certain, mostly priests or some scholars, who know how to do things, how to read the scriptures, how to build a house, and so on. So knowledge is a treasure which is handed down from one generation to the next. And the schooling, between master and disciple, for example, right? Or the pupil and the teacher, is the way it is done. So the teacher, the master, is the one who knows how things are done, who hands it down. And in our modern society, we change in German, you can do it very nicely with the words, we change from Wissen to Wissenschaft. And in the second term, I believe it's similar in Dutch, right? In the second term, Schaft, you hear the dynamic stabilization, so to speak. The highest form of knowledge now is not the handing down of sacred knowledge or something like this, but of producing new knowledge, more knowledge. Max Weber puts this very neatly, and he certainly wasn't a Marxist. He says, the core of science is no longer the school, right? It's the creation of new science, and it's the promise and the knowledge that you create new knowledge where no one was before, something we did not know before, so you go beyond what they before you knew. And Weber says, and you know that those who come after you will go even further. We will go reach with our telescopes deeper into space and with our microscopes deeper into matter. And this is a process that is stabilizing itself dynamically. Go beyond what others did before. And for time reasons, and I don't want to convince you at this point that even politics, we find this logic of dynamic stabilization. It's no longer the king who was there all the time. It's democratic competition, which means every 4 or 5 years you have to gain power, and you do it through the promise of increase. Elect me. There's our elections coming up, so I have to talk about this, right? Check the programs of the political parties. They are always, they live on, they run on promises of increase. Elect me and there will be more jobs. Vote for me and you will have more money. Elect us and there will be more kindergarten places or whatever it is, but it's done through the logic of increase. Okay, and it's the same in art, which is no longer mimetic, but which lives on the idea of originality and innovation. I go where no one was before, right? So the claim is a modern institution, or the logic of modern institutions is of this kind, that they can only stabilize themselves, reproduce the status quo through increase, augmentation, acceleration. Okay. Now, as I said, the question is, if it's true, we need innovation, we need growth, we need acceleration just to stay the same. I mean, what that means basically is that for you, I think most of you are already pressed for time, right? You think, I think I can, I'm now pretty sure because I've made this argument very long, it's probably true for all audiences. So I think most of you, if I asked you how are you doing, you would say, well, I'm quite okay, but I'm so short on time, it's so hectic right now, it's a bit stressful. Well, I got some bad news for you. Next year it will be worse. That's the logic of dynamic stabilization. Actually, I think we only survive it because we think, oh, right now it's hectic, but soon it will be better. But the logic of this game, it won't be better, right? Next year, you have to be a bit faster, I mean, as a society, right? You have to be a bit faster. You somehow need to get the growth engines going, and you have to be a bit more innovative than this year, because if you don't, you lose jobs, companies close down, you will fall back in the PISA studies of how you're doing in the schooling and so on, right? Okay, so we could say, well, we are just the victims. We have to run in this idiotic game. And this, I think, is not true, right? I think it's important to see that this logic of increase, of dynamic stabilization, is also included in our very conceptions, in our human, in our habitus, in our psyche, and certainly in our conception of happiness and of freedom and of the good life. So the question is, what is the conception of the good life you're running on and we are all running on? And now you see here, I call it the triple A approach to the good life. I believe culturally modernity is driven, or this logic of dynamic stabilization, is driven by the promise. Or let me put it differently, what you want, I just claim it and you tell me afterwards if it's all wrong. What you want is, or what you dream of, and I certainly too, is the idea of making a bit more of the world accessible, attainable and available, right? And why is this a promise for you? For example, think of why is money interesting? Some of you might say, I'm not interested in money. I doubt it a bit, right? And if it's true for you, then you're certainly the exception. But generally, money is a quite strong argument. So why is money interesting? Why would you like it to win in the lottery on Saturday?
Well, because money is exactly the main instrument. It's like a magic wand, which makes you the world available, accessible, attainable. If you win in the lottery, you can fly to New York on Saturday if you like, right? Or to Rio or to some other place. If you win in the lottery, you can buy this wonderful car or computer or whatever you dream of. Some might say, I certainly don't dream of a computer. Okay, you can buy the yoga course, which you have always wanted, right? Or go to the Himalayas or somewhere else. But money makes the world accessible, attainable, available in all of its aspects. And why is technology attractive? I think we need to find a motivational force too. And I find it so obvious why technology is interesting. I have the story of the kid. Actually, I grew up in the Black Forest, right? Small village there, relatively small village, let's call it. So why was the first bike great? Why did, as kids, we dream of having a bike and being able to wheel it? Yeah, because it makes the horizon of what is available, it increases it. If I can go by bike, I can visit my friends on the other side of the streak or of the small river or so, right? So I can go further. My world literally extends. I can make more of the world available, accessible, attainable. And certainly the small moped then was even more attractive because with that I could even go to the neighboring village, right? My world extended. I had more of the world available. And with the car, I could even go to Stuttgart or Freiburg or Zurich or so, or even to Berlin or Paris or Nijmegen on the weekend. And with a plane, Rio, New York, Tokyo get into reach, right? And why is a smartphone attractive? Yeah, because I have all my friends now available, accessible, attainable, right? I really believe it's with all technologies. The promise is make more of the world available, accessible, attainable. You might have a smartwatch. Why is that attractive? Because it makes a lot of things first cognitively available, and then you can steer and control it. The calories and the paces you take per day and the blood pressure and I don't know what else it might measure. Make it available, attainable, accessible. Bring it within reach and then also within control. I think this is what we are driven by. And why do most people, this is my last last point here, because otherwise I'll run out of time. Why do most people, actually this is a worldwide phenomenon, why do particularly young people, why do they want to live in cities and not in the small village like the Black Forest? All of our young kids go away once they are 18 or so. And why do they want to live in the big city? They will tell you, well, because there I have the cinema and the theater and the opera, even if they never go to the opera, right? But they have them available, attainable, accessible. It's the knowledge, if I'm in the city, I want to live in the city. There I can go all these places. I have a lot of the world available at an everyday basis, which I do not have elsewhere, right? So I'm pretty sure that the central driving force, the motivational force which runs through us, the power is this promise of making more of the world AAA, right? Here it is. Okay, I leave this aside. Now, why is this a problem? I mean, I think that's the way we live, right? We live in a society, the institutions of which need permanent increase to restabilize themselves, and we live on a motivational basis, on a cultural promise of making the world more and more controllable, knowable, accessible, attainable, and so on. Why is it a problem? I think structurally, what I describe as dynamic stabilization comes with a problem, oh, there's a misspelling there, it comes with a problem of a desynchronization. Not everything in our society, and maybe probably also in our bodies and our souls, if you still believe in a soul, are equally speedable or equally dynamizable, so to speak, right? There are things which you cannot really speed up, which you might destroy if you speed them up or if you try to speed them up. So I call these problems of desynchronization. It doesn't mean, I mean, the fact that some things go fast and some go slow is not a problem unless there is a kind of interface between them. And then that's one of them accelerates. That puts pressure on the slower ones. And I think I can identify quite easily at least four. I think it's at least five, but I have four here. Four forms of desynchronization. Am I going wrong? No. One is the ecological crisis. What we call the ecological problem, in my reading, is a problem of desynchronization because nature has its proper times. It just takes time to, for example, I don't know, I mean, even to, for example, it's interesting, the chicken only produces eggs in a kind of daily rhythm, right? Every day can produce a new X, but that means you have to wait for 24 hours. So actually they have found ways to manipulate that, right? They put the lighting, the lights going on and off, and a 23 hours rate. So the chicken now thinks or feels that the day only has 23 hours per day. So it produces a bit more eggs, but you cannot do this at an indefinite pace. So my claim really is that human beings cut down trees is not a problem for nature. For the beaver, for example, did cut down trees for many thousands of years. The problem is that we cut the trees down at a rate which is too fast for nature to reproduce its forests, and that we fish the ocean at a pace which is too fast for nature to reproduce the fish. And even the what we call the climate problem, it's the global warming, heating up the atmosphere. This is literally speeding up the molecules in some layers of the atmosphere, because heat is directly related to a speed, right? If you heat up a gas, you make the molecules spin faster. So I believe the ecological crisis is a desynchronization between the proper time of nature and the proper time of society, of this logic of dynamic stabilization. But then I believe, and this is what we might see today, there's also a desynchronization between the temporality of democratic policy making, because democracy is not just about taking votes, are you for or against foreigners or so. The logic of democracy, it actually has a lot to do with resonance. It's giving you a voice and the chance to make that voice heard, but not in order to shout at the opponents, but in order to enter into a kind of deliberative dialogue where positions are formulated. And then you enter a process of trying, what I call now resonance, listening and answering. I listen to your arguments and I answer, but not by just insisting on my position. But that's the logic of democratic in the Republican theory tradition, not in Trump's republicanism, but in political theory, right? The idea is that we both change, or we all change, in this kind of deliberative dialogue, right? It's like a concert, really, but it's time. Consuming, formulating positions and entering into deliberation is per se time consuming. And if society becomes more pluralistic, then there are more voices and positions which we have to include. And actually, the decisions become more complex. There are many, many factors and long ranging. If you have to decide about a power plant, a nuclear power station, the consequences will be maybe forever or for thousands of years. So actually, the logic of democratic policy making is rather slowing down than speeding up. But the logic of the markets and of the media is speeding up. So you get serious desynchronization in the proper time of politics and the proper time of the socio-economic system, right? So I believe even the economic crisis which we had after 2008 has something to do with desynchronization, because you can speed up this logic of money, commodity, more money at the financial markets to almost the speed of light. And that's what people do, I mean, or what computers do, because they have introduced computer algorithms which trade and try to, and they do make profits within fractions of seconds. So you can speed up the virtual economy basically to the speed of light, but you can never speed up the so-called real economy to the speed of light. The production of houses and of goods and of books, for example, takes an enormous amount of time, right? And by the way, it's not just the production of goods, it's also the consumption. Because to consume a book is not to buy it, it's to read it. And this is really taking time, right? And it's the same with all the other things. Even to the consumption of clothes is not to put them in your wardrobe, it's to really wear them, right? So the consumption is time consuming and the production are time consuming. And there's desynchronization between the speed of financial markets and the speed of the material economy. But I believe, and I'm personally, and that's where philosophy comes in again, I believe what should interest us and what interests me is the question about the good life, right? What leads to good life for human beings, for us, right? Is this logic of speeding up the world you could basically ask a good thing or a bad thing, even if that's a very simple question or a primitive question. But nevertheless, I mean, basically we find it hard to define what a good thing is, but you can see what a bad thing is. And I think there are some pathologies, psychological pathologies, which could be a hint that the psyche, the psychological processes, maybe also the biological processes, also have their proper times, and there's desynchronization between the speed of what's going on in Facebook and the social media and so on, and the speed of our psychological inner fabric in a way. And I believe, and I think, symptoms of it is burnout, and I will, in the end, which I'm getting towards, I will show you why I think why burnout is a symptom, it's exactly a symptom of the cultural problematic side. By the way, I just read a new study in Germany. There's now, it's every day on the news. I find it interesting. I heard it 3 days in a row that the health insurance, Bauma, the health insurance company, says there is a dramatic increase in people, particularly young people, by the way. I mean, there are a lot of young people here. I'm not sure whether it's a problem for you, but there is an incredible increase in the number of young people who suffer from headaches and who take migraine pills and other forms of pills, right? And they think that this is also related to some form of psychological stress reaction, right? So that could be, alongside burnout, another symptom of why speed and the human psyche are in a kind of desynchronization. Okay, so what is burnout, right? I think burnout is the main symptom of this desynchronization of our psyche, or of what was called the soul once. You can still call it the soul if you like, but if you're a sociologist, you better should not talk about the soul, because you immediately get into trouble. So the psyche. So what is burnout, so to speak, or what is the flip side of modernity? Well, basically my idea here is this. I'm now turning to the cultural side. I mean, I tried to present you what is motivating us. Now I want to figure out whether something might be wrong. We might not get what we want. Something might be wrong with the promise. And this I find my maybe most interesting insight right now. I think there is a fascinating flip side. We are driven by the promise to make the world accessible, attainable, available. I want to go places. I want to hear melodies, sounds that can't be made. The great Marillion title is, and so on. So this is kind of driving us forward. But then we experience some strange flip side, that the world we have made available, accessible, attainable, turns silent, goes away from us, right? It's not answering. So somehow there seems to be the flip side, that we lose the world as we make it attainable and available and accessible. It doesn't speak to us. I mean, I can give you, if only I had time, let me give you two short examples of this. I just was invited to Erhard Eppler. He's a German social democratic politician. You probably don't know him anymore. He's turned 90. So I was invited to his, there was an official kind of birthday thing. So he is considered, and he actually is, one of the first critics of the growth, of the logic of growth and acceleration, and of he was debating the ecological concern, and so he was asked in an interview, how did you get into this? How did you turn into a critic of growth of the logic of growth and into how did you develop ecological concerns? And he says, well, he actually wanted to be in the foreign office, but he made the minister of development, right? So he went to Morocco on one of his first trips, and from the airplane he saw that the Moroccans at that point in time, it was in the late 60s, they actually were trying to get higher, climb higher up the mountains. They cut down the forest, right, in order to have cattle and other things and housing moving higher up the hills. And they also went deeper into the forest. That's exactly what I mean, expanding the reach of the world, right? It's the AAA strategy, making more of the world available, accessible, attainable. And he said, and he realized that the opposite came true, that Earth did not become more fruit, more flourishing, so to speak, but there was erosion, right? And the river took away all the fertile ground, and the consequence of this was that the world, the land, the forest, and the hills did not become kind of nurturing world, right? But the opposite, arid world, eroded world. It was in the end the fertile soil was driven to the ocean. So I think this is so to speak, the literal image of what I want to say. As we try to make the world available, accessible, attainable, it turns arid. It doesn't speak to us. My other example for this is, maybe you like music. Music is an interesting thing, particularly as a modern phenomenon, because, as I would say, right, music is an axis of resonance where you feel alive, where you feel somehow, actually where you literally feel alive, right? Something is touching you, something is speaking to you, and you answer it, right, by crying. So very often people have tears in their eyes when they are really touched by music. So now, of course, you have this logic, triple A, I want to have more music available, accessible, attainable. So mostly I'm addicted. I always go to CD and record stores and buy records. So I have now more of the records available at home, right? The problem is that I realized the less I got from the CDs, the more I bought. So now I have hundreds of CDs maybe which I never listened to. But Spotify is much worse, right? Spotify is the dream of the triple A come true. For €9, you have millions of titles available, accessible, attainable, right? Right? It's easy, with one click, millions of titles. So is your life, is your musical experience getting better by a million times like this? I think the danger is that with this overwhelming commodity or range of offers, none of them speaks to you anymore. And I just found interesting empirical evidence for this. I find this really fascinating. I read a study which said that with this streaming, it's the same with movies, right? So you no longer buy a movie where you select, well, I want to see this movie. Oh no, you buy into streaming, into this kind of streaming companies, and then you have millions of titles. So you would think, oh, this is great, right? The accelerationists certainly will say, this is wonderful, now we have millions of titles. But in fact, there is a study which says that those who do streaming, and with this logic of streaming, fewer and fewer films are actually watched. Right, the films which people really watch are just the blockbusters. There is an incredible move towards the mainstream blockbusters, right? And there are millions of titles of films or music which are just bought or listened to once or twice or so, right? So what I want to say is, maybe it's not the best of all possible examples. What I want to say is that there seems to be a kind of flip side, where making the world available, obtainable, and accessible sometimes distances us from the world. The world becomes silent. And by the way, of course, my claim is that burnout is the main case of this. People who are in burnout, they would say, I have a job, I have a family, I have lots of offices or so, and lots of CDs and movies and other things and yoga courses, but none of them touches me. None of them speaks to me. I feel totally empty and dead inside. And it feels like the world is gray and silent outside there too. And by the way, there's an interesting medical study which says that people who are in a burnout or depression, because I believe burnout is just one form of depression, they literally see the world in like through a grayish a shield, right? The world turns literally gray when you're depressed. And in my reading now, it means the axis of resonance are dead, right? You no longer feel alive in that sense. So what I want to say is that modernity from the beginning, I would really say, from the 18th century on, there was this fear that we might lose the world, that the world turns silent, empty, dead. And now a very short glimpse at where you find it. You certainly find it with Max Weber, who said this process of rationalization, what is rationalization for Weber? Making the world controllable, predictable, and so on, right? So it's triple A. And he says the flip side is disenchantment. Just listen to the word, disenchantment. It stops to sing. The world becomes silent and dead. Yeah, it's available, it's calculable, it's controllable. But somehow it loses its color, its magic, it doesn't speak anymore. And I believe even Durkheim's anomia can be understood in this way, but I don't want to go into Durkheim at this point. It's a bit complicated. Simmel is much easier. Simmel says, if for modernity, our attitude towards the world becomes blasé towards things. It's actually, to my students, I always tell, it's coolness, right? Something drastic happens and you just say, oh, I don't mind, right? So you're no longer touched, you're no longer affected. It's the blasé attitude towards things, where you always say, oh, I've seen better, or I've seen deeper, or things like that. And Simmel also says the attitude towards each other becomes latently aversive, right? Don't come too close, I don't want to be touched. by you, right? It's quite interesting. There's a book produced in Jena about this, the untouchable society, so to speak. We no longer want to get into physical contact with each other, right? Unless in intimate relationships, or whether we need professionals who kind of, there are professional huggers and this kind of things, right? Because there's latent aversion towards things. So these are just, I think, and then there's Hannah Arendt. I mean, there are many different versions who all make the same point. We lose the world. Hannah Arendt writes about the loss of the world through our loss of political action. She says, we only gain the world. We make the world alive. We create it through direct political action. And since when we lose this, we actually lose the world. And Albert Camus, I love, because his definition of the absurd, the birth of the absurd, is the result when we realize that we cannot but shout into the world, yell into the world, and we only experience its silence back. Absurdity is the existential experience that the world in its existence is actually, it's either totally indifferent to us or even hostile. So that's the relationship of what I call alienation. The world doesn't speak. The world actually doesn't, it doesn't relate to us. It doesn't answer. There is no resonance. And of course, with Karl Marx, or from Karl Marx, we can, it's not originally from Marx, but Marx developed it at great length, in the early Marx in particular. He calls it alienation. He says our modern mode of existence, and the early Marx actually thinks that capitalism is already the result of alienation, of a wrong way of being in the world. And alienation means that somehow our work, the products of our works, then the others, the other people with whom we only compete, and in the end, nature and ourselves, we get alienated from all of these, right? And Lukács then kind of defines the opposite side. There is reification. In the way you encounter each other, you encounter your work and yourself, there is a kind of instrumental relationship. You know, that's what Adorno and Horkheimer then said. It's the instrument. It's the advance of instrumental reason. Right? It's the calculation. It's the availability we increase. But there seems to be a loss of something other. Now the question, of course, is. Okay, at this point, I made a small break. I mean, if it's true what I said so far, then we have two problems. Structurally, we have the problem of desynchronization, which in the ecology and the politics and in other, maybe even in psychology, leads to serious problems. But culturally, our dream of making the world available, accessible, attainable doesn't work out fine, right? It leads to the opposite. We lose the world. So the question is of what are we going to do about it? What can we change it? Could we even think of changing it? In the Speed book, I was totally pessimistic. Not in the Dutch version, because there I already have this, I wrote another chapter for you, which introduces what I want to introduce you now. So, but obviously, if we want to get out of this, we need two things. We need a kind of new institutional or structural fabric. But of course, it couldn't be a society which is static. The idea is that a society could just reproduce itself as it is and remain static. Stationary society, in some interpretation, is totally impossible, I would say, right? Because societies always have to change. And societies always did change. And certainly, all societies sometimes innovate or accelerate or grow. In some respects, at least, they grow. So I think the opposite of dynamic stabilization is not static stabilization, but adaptive stabilization. Adaptive means society should be capable of growing, of accelerating, of innovating when there is a need for it or a sense of it. If you want to change the status quo because there is a new disease, then of course you need a new technology or so. Or if there is a shortage on food, then you need to grow in the food production. So if you want to change the status quo, you should be capable of innovating, accelerating, and growing. And that's why I'm not even, at least not in the sense of the term, I'm not propagating degrowth. Let's shrink in any case. A post-growth society, as I envision it, and my colleagues in Jena too, is not a society which never grows. It's only a society which does not have to grow just in order to stay the same. Okay? So we need structurally, we need adaptive stabilization. This is not my problem, because we have a project in Jena, the so-called post-growth project, and there we have a kind of division of labor. Klaus Dörre has to deal with the economic structures, right, of course, we discuss it and debate it. But the idea here is that we want to come up with some vision of an economic democracy, which has a place for market and competition, but a limited place, right? Because we want to get beyond the capitalist logic of increase. So we need an economic reforms, and we also need a reform of the welfare state, because the current welfare state only survives, it operates, it runs on the redistribution of product which is growing. And also for motivational reasons, I'm personally a strong advocate of a guaranteed basic income. But my personal, what I've been working on over the last couple of years is on this motivational side, right? Our conception of the good life as the triple A, making the world available, attainable, accessible, is not leading to a good life. It's leading to burnout, to put it very bluntly, to the alienated world. So what we need is actually another conception of the good life. And here it is. And then I'm done. I mean, what I try to say, actually I left something out, that in critical theory, I think really critical theory, all of those writers had exactly this impression that a capitalist modernity somehow produces alienation of one form or the other, the silent world. But you see it with Marcuse, of course. He used the concept of alienation and the one-dimensional society. And you see it with Fromm. He also used the concept of alienation. And with Adorno and with Walter Benjamin, right? I don't want to go into Benjamin here. But you see it through the whole tradition of critical theory, even with Honneth or with Habermas, the colonization of the life world, the imperatives for growth, by the way, kill the living spirit, the resonance within the life world. So now my claim is that, interestingly, even the most pessimist writers of critical theory, like Adorno, I think Adorno probably is the most pessimist, I'd say so, even they had some vague idea of how it could be different. All of the writers I presented to you had some vague but very unclear conception of a non-alienated, of a non-dead and silent world. I believe, by the way, that Weber had... What was Weber's tool against disenchantment? I believe it was charisma, right? I mean, we know it had some dangerous side effects. But Weber's idea was that we need charismatic relationships between people and towards the world, people with vision who breathe life into the colorless world, so to speak, right? And then Walter Benjamin has this very strange conception of the aura. Aura is a very ambivalent term. Actually, he changed the meaning of it very often. But the idea is that the aura around things or of a landscape or so is something that is against this reifying, alienating contact. It's something that when you feel that the world looks at you, right, then you feel the aura of things. So it's a different form of contact, facing each other. And Adorno had this idea of a mimetic relationship when you are really touched, and also of real experience, where you're overwhelmed by something. And auf das Hinzutretende, Adorno is of course very dark on this side. And Erich Fromm, he is more straightforward. He wanted to introduce the concept of love. The relationship of love is different from the triple A approach. But my favorite here, clearly my favorite, is Herbert Marcuse. What I call the triple A approach for him is the Promethean stance towards the world, right? Making the world available, accessible, attainable, control it, reach it, and so on. And he says that's very bad. That means that the world becomes a point of aggression. Whenever you see something, you either want to have it or to control it or to appropriate it in a certain sense. And he says, and he dreams of an erotic relationship instead of a Promethean. And erotic is not about sex. He says that's the problem of modernity, that we think eroticism is all about sex. He says it's possible to have an erotic relationship, this kind of living interchange, even with your work, right? It could be a very different way of working. So the question I wanted to deal with in my book on resonance, which has 800 pages, is this. How can we define and conceptualize a charismatic, auratic, erotic, and a mimetic form of being in the world? What's alienation's other? If it's true that alienation might be the price of the AAA approach, then what's another mode of existence? And this is how I arrived at the resonance conception. I believe it's the last slide, right? So my main claim is that the AAA approach has this idea of making the world, in Deutsch, verfügbar, right? Making things AAA, available, attainable, accessible. But it's like with the music. Now I have billion titles, available, accessible, attainable. But is that what I want from music? No. Why do I want to have 9 million titles? Because I believe that then I will find the one or the 10 titles that truly speak to me, that touch me, right? So my dream actually is I want the extension of the horizon and of the scope, because I hope that in that way I will find the music that truly touches me. And by the way, I want to have more Facebook friends, because I believe in that way I find my real friends, my true friends, those I can really enter into a relationship with. So my claim is, what we are really looking for is resonance. And resonance has the following features. Moments of resonance, you all know it. It's the moments where you, for example, have tears in your eyes, right? For whatever. And it's not only music. Sometimes you have it because you hear a story of some person, or you read an idea in a book, or you see a wonderful landscape or so. Or you are so immersed in your work that you feel resonance of this sort. So resonance has the following features. It's a relationship towards the world, towards each other, but also towards yourself. When you really feel touched, affected by something, right? So when you really feel that, well, that this is something that speaks to me, this is something that really means something to me, even though I'm a bit against the cognitive side of it, because resonance is a very physical thing. Something touches you. When you experience a moment of resonance, you feel it in your body. When something trickles down your spine, right, or your hair stand up, or you develop goosebumps. Those are something touches you. So that's one element of resonance, but it's not enough. A resonant relationship with the world, in politics, in your work, but even in art, is when you answer this call. The one element is a call. You feel something is calling you. But the other side is you answer it, right? And this is, I use Bandura's conception of self-efficacy. It's not just that one element of the world is touching you, it's you answer it, you reach out, you do something yourself, you feel that you are also capable of connecting to this other thing. So the second element is self-efficacy, which you see here, right? So resonance, a resonant relationship with the world, which is the opposite of the Promethean stance, is a relationship where you are touched and where you, in a form of efficacy, which is not the efficacy of instrumental control, but the efficacy of reaching out and transforming yourself in this process. That are two crucial elements of resonance. But, of course, and therefore, it's not echo. It's not when you hear yourself again, right? But that's why, by the way, I only put it in one sentence. This is why I think the Nazis, or even Trump, or... No, I don't want to go into the Dutch scene, all right. some say, well, aren't they creating resonance? Isn't it exactly about resonance? I believe it's the reaction to a loss of resonance. People feel that there is no resonance in politics, right? That they are not heard, they are not seen, they are not touched, they are not meant, not affected. So they want to make their voices heard. And that's why they go to Trump and Wilders and all the others. But then the answers they give is the answer is, so to speak, the idea of an echo. Let's fuse into one identical voice. So the idea is, let's not listen to the other, which is really an other we might experience and encounter. Let's silence the other. We don't want the Muslims here. We don't want the refugees here. We don't want the experts here, right? We only want to hear ourselves. Let's silence all the other voices. And the end result is that you don't even hear your own voice, but it's fused in the kind of empty voice. So that is what I call an echo, because the idea of resonance is not that we want to stay as we are. The idea of resonance is you hear something that touches and affects you and which you answer, and thereby you transform. And that's exactly what you would tell me. If I asked you, did you have any experiences of resonances in your life, or excess of resonance where you frequently make this experience, then you would certainly tell me, yes, I read this book, or I heard that music, or I met this person, or I traveled to that country, and afterwards I was a different person. That's exactly what resonance does. It has a transformative effect, because you listen to some other voice which is different from you. It's not about identity, it's difference. And then there's transformation. By trying to get in touch with this difference, you change. That's why I think resonance is a concept that goes beyond the old dichotomy between either identity politics or the politics of difference. Resonance makes you change, and it makes you encounter difference, but the different does not only stay different. You can get in touch with it. You can experience a kind of co-transformation. And the final feature of this is this. And this is why resonance is against, why the logic of dynamic stabilization undercuts in the long run the possibility for resonance, because resonance is always unpredictable. In Deutsch, I call it, es hat immer einen Moment der Unverfügbarkeit. It's elusive, And what I mean is that you can never, you can do what you want. You cannot guarantee that you will get into resonance, right? You might go to your favorite concert tonight, and it's the best singer, and you have the best cards, tickets or so, and the best seats, and maybe nothing happens, right? You feel totally bored. We all know this. Then we try to convince ourselves that it was really good. I think conversations, I want to make an empirical study on conversations where you see the desperate attempt that people that people who paid a lot of money, right, and went to the great show, they say, it was really great, it was fantastic, and there's a kind of overwhelming, the light was overwhelming and the sound was overwhelming, but that's not being touched by something different that transforms you. So what I want to say is that you can never make sure that resonance happens. You might go to your favorite place in the holiday resort, the mountain you always loved, and you go there and you feel totally pissed by the rain or so. So, or it's like Christmas Eve, right? On Christmas Eve, there's hectic until 5 o'clock, and then afterwards you want to be in total resonance with your family. And what happens? Deep alienation. So what I want to say is, you cannot make sure that resonance happens, but that's not the only thing that's elusive about it. The other is you cannot accumulate it and increase it. For example, if you have a favorite piece of music, Marillion would be a good suggestion, and then you say, oh, now I found it, I have my access of resonance. It's Marillion's song, The Invisible Man, for example. And then I listen to it every day or 5 times a day, right? It won't increase resonance, it will kill it. Right, so you cannot accumulate it in that sense. You cannot store it and save it and put it away. You cannot accumulate it. You cannot control it. And what's the worst of it? You don't exactly know what the result of transformation might be. If you really get into resonance with a person, with a refugee, for example, who might come to Holland, or with a book you haven't thought before, if you really travel to Polynesia or some other place, not as a tourist who goes from the pizza to the hotel to the disco, but if you really go into a different culture, you don't know what it will do to you. You cannot control the outcome of resonance, right? So I believe that this logic of dynamic stabilization forces us into a mode of optimization, of efficiency, of increase, of growth, and of availability, of controllability. So the logic of increase and the logic of resonance are against each other. And this is why I believe the resonance conception can provide a kind of cultural counterforce against the logic of dynamic stabilization. I do not want to say that it's only us, the individuals, who need to change. Actually, I mean, operaism isn't so bad. Do you really want to tell me I still have time? No. 2 minutes, okay. Well, I'm done anyway. I mean, I don't want to say it's all a matter of individuals. That's the great thing about resonance. Look, when I wrote my speed book, I was really pessimistic because I was pissed by all the books who said, well, it's your problem. If you have a time problem, you should be better in time management, right? You just aren't capable of saying no. You are too greedy. And I thought, well, if everyone is incapable of saying no and bad in time management, then probably it's not our problem. It's a structural, institutional problem. So the result of the speed book was there's nothing we can do about it. And in the end, I found this a bit too pessimistic too. Now, but I still hate the books who say it's all up to you. And this is why I'm a bit at odds with the mindfulness stuff, right? Because I think mindfulness and yoga and these kind of things, they have a lot to do with resonance. It's people trying to get in resonance with themselves and the world. But they think it's all up to us as a subject. If you're in the right set of mind, you will be in resonance with everything, no matter what the world is like. Now, resonance says it's not a state of mind. It's a relationship, and a relationship has two ends. So if you're not in resonance, it might be your fault, right? Maybe even physically. I mean, autism is a very interesting, I don't think autists are incapable of resonance all the way through, but there seems to be some problem with the resonance, with emotional resonance. So maybe there are physical requirements, and there certainly are psychological experiences which might make you incapable of, or which might make it difficult for you to experience resonance. Because if you are traumatized, if your experience with encountering the world is getting hurt, and then you might close yourself. The world is a threat, because being capable of going into a mode of resonance means being capable and willing to encounter the risk of vulnerability and being vulnerable, right? You don't know what the other does to you if you're open. So there are psychological requirements and physical requirements, but there is also the other side, the institutional side. It depends on the institutions we interact with, whether we are in resonance with each other. If we are in an institutional frame which puts us into a competitive system, then resonance gets very difficult because you cannot compete and resonate with a person at the same time. You might say, yes, in sports you can. I really thought about this very, very long because I thought, well, that's strange. Either my argument is wrong or it's not a resonance in sports. Now I find the solution. In sports, you can really be in resonance and compete, but that's not because of the logic of competition. It's because of the play. In game, right, in playing or in games, they are capable of creating a sphere of resonance. And that's what gives you resonance in sports. But nevertheless, for example, temporal pressure is exactly a thing that an institutional thing which you cannot solve yourself that kills the possibility of resonance. And this you can prove even with your neurons, with the imaging, with the data processing of images of our mind, for example. If you put people on temporal stress, right, and if you install fear, for example, there's an exams, final exam in the university or so, right, then you certainly, you cannot and you should not try to get in resonance with anything, not even with the material you're working at. You have to be fast, efficient, and block out anything that might touch and transform you. So what I want to say is when you think about the conditions of resonance, if you try to formulate a critique of the conditions of resonance, if we try to formulate a critique of the conditions of resonance, we can look at subjects, but we certainly have to look at the institutional spheres. They are physical, they are temporal, they are spatial, architectural preconditions of resonance, of the possibility of resonance or of being in resonance with the world. So what I want to say is that we need a dual revolution. One is structural, get over this kind of capitalist system, and one is cultural, get over capitalism within us. Thank you very much.
Yeah, first of all, thank you very much for using smileys in your presentation.
Yes, I did.
Haven't seen that in a long time. That's nice. Peter, maybe there's a very simple and question I just need to ask. Is this presentation resonating in you? The resonance resonating? What do you?
Yeah, it certainly resonates.
Want to feel like starting a revolution right now?
No, well, you talked a lot about resonance, but at the very end, you mentioned the word capitalism two times, right? We should do away with the institutional, you know, with capitalism as a system, and with the capitalism in us, right? Mm. This Protestant capitalist in us. I very much agree with that, but I didn't see that back in your talking about resonance.
But in talking about dynamic stabilization, I mean that's part of that.
Yeah, but let's talk about resonance.
Okay.
First, right?
Yeah.
It's a very, very, very interesting concept, and you oppose it to autonomy, in a sense.
Yes.
But how to create the social conditions? Yeah. In a way in which these resonances can somehow happen. Mm. And for that, I think you really need to think about capitalism or the capitalist institutions, because if you do not do away with that, it will be very difficult, I think, to create resonances in offices and in factories, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, this...
Yeah,
you see the problem.
Yes, I see. Yeah,
it's a very nice criterion.
It's a very tough. I mean, it's a very tough problem. But I'm still. This is something we always discuss in Germany, and I think I'm getting even more stubborn. I mean, for one thing, I think the question is how do we do away with capitalism? How do we do it? And I think it's important to see two things. I mean, one is how. We need motivational power to overcome this system. And basically, capitalism creates two kinds of problems. One is injustice, exploitation, which is a very bad problem. And the other is a kind of alienation, a wrong way of being set towards the world. And now I'm really convinced that this second problem is the deeper problem, right? It's at the root which makes even possible this form of exploitation. And I think we have to overcome this. I believe I'm in total accordance with critical theory. What people like Adorno and Marcuse were concerned with, that's why Marcuse wrote The One-Dimensional Man, is that we don't even see that it's possible of being in the world in a different way. Right? And I believe this kind of class struggle, I really believe there are two Marxes, right? One is the class, they are both in the Communist Manifesto, very easy. One is the class struggle, right? History is about class struggle and you have to decide on where you are. But I think this actually puts you into the kind of fight mode, which is already almost a part of availability, attainability, and accessibility. So I believe the alienation Marx, right, where capital, if capital is the subject of the whole system, and that's what Marx also says, right, then even the winners, the bad guys, are part of this logic, right? And that's why I believe my idea of revolution is deeper than just struggling the neoliberals. I'm totally in favor of struggling against the neoliberals. But I think we need two things. We need an idea. We desperately need to keep alive the idea that a different form of life is possible, number one. And number two is I believe we have a sense. We do have a sense, and that's the interesting question. Maybe you disagree there. I believe we have the sense of a different way of being in the world, what I call resonance. I have to write a reply to some critics, right? Mm-hmm. And they say, oh, Rosa is in truth, he's not a revolutionary, he is affirmative, right? He has found consolation, mm-hmm. Reconciliation with the living condition, because he says people can experience resonance in their work, mm-hmm. but they can't in a capitalist society, right? And I'm really thinking about this. I believe it's totally. I don't address this to you, but to my critics. Mm-hmm. I find it totally arrogant. If we sociologists tell the people that if they experience some form of resonance while maybe nursing in a hospital or so, right, or teaching in a school, or producing bread as a baker, oh, this is all wrong. If you think that's joy, that's exactly the bad thing, right?
Oh yeah,
but I find really this is very, very, very bad. I think, and this is taking away the motivational force from them.
Yeah, I very much agree. But this will not change the system ultimately. We talked about it during our ate. There are at the moment some British Marxists, so-called accelerationists, right? Like Nick Trinek and Alex Williams, who wrote this Accelerationist Manifesto not so long ago. And they really criticize what they call folk politics. Like everything that happens, for instance, in Occupy and anarchists, doing local politics, etc., small is beautiful, etc., which is very much in favor now. And they argue for the need to go back to a systematic critique of capitalism and to scale it up in a way and to accelerate and be more modern because that's the only way to overcome the system, right? So whereas
that's not the only way.
Well, that's not my opinion, but I would be very interested in
yeah, actually, now you say it, you've put it this way, I'm even more aggressive against it.
Right. Well. But
I have to write this, but for the following reason, I really think, but because it's a symmetrical reproach, right? I mean, basically, they claim, or people argue. I mean, there are many different versions of this. They claim that what I do, in fact, is kind of it's doing folk politics, and in the end, it's affirmation which keeps the system going. And I would say, no, that's what they do. Because what they do is really, look what they tell the people is, what you think is your joy, right? In, for example, people experience joy in consumption and work. Mm. It's totally mistaken. That's the deepest form of alienation. Mm. What you think is bad, what Occupy or other protestations do against, that's wrong too. Mm. So basically they tell the people you have no self-efficacy at all. You're totally wrong in everything you do. First learn my language game. My super abstract formula, which doesn't ring anything. It doesn't trigger any emotional experience. But what they really tell, I mean, this is really, I think if I was a neoliberal, I would give all the money to them. Because they tell the people, you know, what you think is good is totally bad. What you think is bad is totally bad too. You have to learn my hyper abstract language game and then we can talk about things. Yeah, I mean, that's the safest way to keep capitalism in place.
Yeah, but let's defend them a little.
No.
They're certainly it's certainly a kind of neo-communism in the way that what is important is to retake back the means of production, right? Because in a capitalist system, one reason for our alienation is the fact that we cannot together collectively dispose over our means of production, right?
Yeah, but I
think that's still an important issue. Yeah. And they are very much in favor of commonizing the means of production in whatever sense they think that is possible. But this is one of the conditions to fight this alienation.
Yeah, but I don't know. I mean, it's really my personal experience. This is mind nerve-wracking and mind-dumping. I mean, because we have these at the students, and I like them. They are the brightest, basically, right? And they always they go back to very abstract critique. And whenever you have a problem, for example, there's a problem with the refugees, right? Mm-hmm. So what do we do about them? Oh, it's the basic conditions of capitalism we have to overcome more so. And there's an ecological problem. And they always tell you it's the value logic, or however they put it, right, which is the problem. And this doesn't trigger anything. I mean, look, I was blamed, and I realize it. I find it, it's a game, but it's a serious game, right? And I'm not saying I'm right, but I want to defend my idea. So I really have a problem. I mean, the people arguing like you are, like the accelerationists, they say...
I'm not an accelerationist.
Oh, okay, no. But what you tried right now. I mean, they say it's quite tricky, because in my resonance book, I tried to explain, I described two people, or actually four people, in a very ideal typic schematic way. And one or two of them, they are they are seeking resonance in their everyday life, right, in their workplace and in everywhere, right, and they are also experiencing it. And then actually one guy, and that made me think a lot, said, a young student in Munich said, you know what, because I presented two persons, one is Hannah and one is Anna, and Anna is always kind of alienated. She dislikes her work, she dislikes her family, basically. It's always, nothing happens, right? And Hannah somehow likes her work. She feels that she really loves her kids, and even when she plays volleyball, she loves the experience of the game and of her body and so on. And then someone said, I definitely prefer the alienated one, right? I think in this world, to permanently be in love and inspired by your work, and that's totally bad. And I thought, fuck, there might be some truth to this, right? But now I really, but I have complementary figures, I don't want to go into them, but Dorian and Adrian, but now I really, started to think, which of the two women, I mean, they're totally ideal typic anyway, will probably try to do something for the refugees and against climate politics. Mm. I think so. You have to have this sense of resonance, really. I mean, the question is, what do you feel when you see the refugees in the Mediterranean Sea? Do you say, oh yeah, that's the logic of capitalism, I always knew it, we will never overcome it? Or do you just feel challenged, you want to do something, and then you will realize in the end that the problem is in the economic system?
Yeah, but
that's way to get there.
One moment. You were very critical about mindfulness. And I very much agree with that, because mindfulness is something that is very much instrumentalized at the moment with corporations, right?
You can
use it to make your people more productive. Could not resonance be abused in the same time? That's my suspicion in a way.
I agree with that.
I like it as a criterion, but I don't see it as how from this resonance logic, the logic of resonance, how... This could function as a kind of escape route to another social system altogether, because that's what we actually want, right? We want.
I want to go to the beginning of your lecture. You mentioned at the beginning that there's some motivational lure in this, maybe the AAA.
Yeah.
So there's a promise. There's something we really want.
Yes.
So you were talking about the neoliberal. Isn't it what you're trying to do to help us grapple with our own, the neoliberal in ourselves, you know?
Yes,
so
yes,
not
exactly.
Only saying...
That's what I mean, yeah.
Yeah. While you're trying to continually find the enemy outside
yes,
the system
exactly
or something,
what I mean.
We have to go within.
At least
absolutely, the enemy is really inside. But I
maybe we
but
should
not
turn
for
to
those,
the...
Not for your Marxists or accelerationists, because it's really true.
Yes.
I mean,
that's another question altogether. Where is the class question here?
It's both. I mean, the enemy is both. Where's the what?
Where is the class question in your analysis?
The class question.
The question of class.
The class question.
With C. How does it play into the resonance issue? It's just a question of.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe
it's
class critical. First, but I want to delve into the enemy within. I find that.
You know, I have. I will try to link them up. I mean, first, I mean.
Great.
I mean, the danger you suggested. That is the danger I really fear, and I actually wrote about it in my book. I see them on the shelves, right? How to be more successful through resonance in your job? How to have a better family life with resonance? And I really hate that, right? And I think. Look, the thing is, resonance has a transformative power. It doesn't mean that you get better in what you already are. And you cannot, my claim is, that's why the elusiveness, the Unverfügbarkeit is so important, right? You cannot control it in that sense. And there's one great example, which I really love about some, because of course, that's exactly what companies do. I have a chapter on the commodification of resonance on both ends.
Okay.
That's very important. Yes. I mean, it's done in consumption. And how does advertisement work? And it's not just advertisement, how do products work? They promise us resonance. I mean, you cannot buy anything without the promise of resonance. Buy this car and you will feel self-efficacy and a resonant way of being in the landscape. Buy this deo and you feel resonance with your body. Buy these chips and you will have real friendship. It's really true. They always sell you products. But what it does is they transform our desire, I believe even anthropological desire or yearning for resonance, into a desire for the commodity. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that the commodity does not work, right? But that's exactly this thing with the enemy within. I believe we can actually look inside and then realize that there's something wrong with the way we deal with it. But there's commodification on the production side too, right? That of course companies say, yes, what we need is teams which are very much in resonance with each other. They need to find out if someone is in a bad mood today, then we should give you a day off or so. Mm. And you should be resonant with yourself. Right, you listen to yourself and then the inspiring idea comes about. But the funny thing is about the elusiveness. I read about a kind of consultant company, right, a coaching company, which sent a team into a kind of, I would almost call it a resonance camp. Mm-hmm. And people really got into resonance. And when they came back, they all resigned. They quit their jobs. They said, okay. They didn't say we get into resonance, but we discussed things and we thought it through and we changed, we transformed. I don't want this job anymore. So that's why I hope that resonance has at least some excess power over this. Now with the class struggle, I mean, there are many things to say really. I mean, one is on one level, I believe there's the class problem, it's exploitation, which is there. So the question is, how do we become exploitation? And I think those who are concentrating on the class struggle, they think, let's solve injustice or the class problem first, then we can deal with alienation. And I think we should do it the other way around, right? This class system will only break down if we take the motivational energy, which is within, from both sides, from the ruling class and from the other class. But then the question is, then my colleagues would say, but it's about resources. You cannot be in resonance if you don't have any resources, which I think is definitely true, right? If you feel hunger or if you feel pain or coldness or if you are really oppressed by someone, the oppression is always killing resonance. You cannot develop your own voice. You cannot really be...
I agree.
So you certainly need enough resources in order to get into resonance. But you do not all need more and more and more resources. And I think even the trade unions are in this logic of more. I mean, that's exactly the slogan of the German trade unions. We for more. We want more, basically, right? Mm. So I think we need to break out of this...
this more.
Yeah, but what would the proper be? Because you mentioned the proper time, the proper amount, the word proper came up at some point, at several points.
Yes, that's
so what would the proper be, you know? Would it be some point in time... That it was fantastic and good and that
that's not what. I mean this. I definitely sound like that, right? And that's what people also say. Yeah. Once was a time when the world was resonance. Now we unfortunately lost it. No, I'm only talking about promises in my presentation, right? There was this promise, but apparently it didn't deliver. The modernity did not deliver, because in former times, whenever it is. I could easily and very quickly tell you forever decades, right, or every century, why that was not a resonant world. If you live in an oppressive, for example, take gender aspects, right? I mean, women for most time, most societies, and for most ages, were not allowed to develop their own voice at all. Basically, they were made totally irresonant. I mean, they were forced. It's like putting a finger on someone. You may not have your own job, you may not have your own sexuality, maybe, or your own religion, or if you do things like that, right? You oppress, for example, sexuality or religion or whatever it is. Then you immediately kill resonance. So I'm not saying there was, it's like Bloch says, I find Bloch really wonderful there. He talks about home, and home sounds very conservative and nostalgic. And he says, Heimat in the German sense, mm-hmm. right? Heimat is the country where we have never been. No one ever was there. But it's the idea, it's the regulative idea where we want to go. And we know it from childhood because as kids, we cannot but kind of develop a resonant relationship with the world. But it's not proper, it's not in any historical sense.
Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah. Let's ask the question again from the accelerationist perspective. Is resonance scalable? When I think about what is an ideal resonant situation, this would be like a tribal situation, right? You're with like 600-700 people in a tribe, there's a fire, there's music, etc., and there's a song, and then you start resonating, feel yeah. together, feel empowered, feel this unity, right? This tribal unity. I can imagine that you know, on this scale, but could there be like a resonant society? Can we scale it up onto the level of nations or even to the level maybe of cities? I have a lot of sympathy for the concept of resonance, but how are there technologies of resonance? Shouldn't we think about technologies of resonance in a way? So
I know.
Another question, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Temporality is very much a technical thing, right? It's very much something yeah. that is conditioned
no time
by
without technique.
Yes, yeah. exactly. Well, it is conditioned.
But, I mean, yeah. I mean, there. Actually, I want to say something. Let me start with that. One last thing about the class thing, okay?
Yeah, okay.
because I find really interesting about the class problem also is the Bourdieuian question. How do classes kind of stay so stable? How is inequality reproduced?
Mm-hmm.
And as Bourdieu thinks, and I think he's quite right there, it's through the educational system, through the schooling mainly, or not only, of course, but that's a strong argument. And how is it done? And I believe our educational system, our schools redistribute or reproduce the capacity for resonance in an unequal way, right? Because for some, school is a kind of sphere of alienation. And then these kids have the experience that politics is nothing that interests me, right? And poems, I hate poems, right? And biology, oh no, it's all awful.
Mm.
So basically, they live in a dead and silent world in an additional sense. While for the successful, the winners in the educational system, all these fears start to speak and to resonate, right? So I really believe the reproduction of inequality is done through making some classes kind of. Alienating them additionally. It's a very dangerous argument, but I think that's one part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
But now to your scaling question, I mean, with the tribes, I'm not even sure, and this gives me another problem about the anthropological, but what you described with the tribes is not, technically speaking, resonance in my sense.
Okay.
Because the question is, what is the voice of the other, and what is their own voice? It's the fusion so it's almost like an ecosphere,
mm-hmm.
unless I mean, they believe they experience the power of some other, of course.
Yeah, because otherness is a very important aspect.
Yes.
Because you want to, I read in your book, we are done with autonomy, right?
Yeah.
We have to redefine or rethink autonomy in a way in its relationship with heteronomy.
Yes.
And that there your concept of resonance comes in, which is in this ray, it's resonating against something that, comes outside of you is alien to you
yes.
in a way.
Yeah, I mean that's the core of it. So you need both. You need the capacity to develop your own voice, but you also need the capacity to be open to this otherness which transforms you.
Yeah.
And but with the world as such. If you've read the book, you know I have this idea of a vertical sphere of resonance, which is the idea that we have a need almost, I would say, to somehow get in touch with whatever we think ultimate reality is, with the world as such, or with life as such, or with nature as such. I believe it's kind of impossible to kill that desire, right? And of course, this is
the sacred, ultimately.
Yeah.
Well,
this is what I don't know, actually. Maybe it's very close to the idea of a sacred, right? Of some form of sacred, right?
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it can be religion, right? The idea of the religion, in my reading, is the promise of resonance. There is someone, a God, right, who hears and seeks, who hears and sees you, who actually called you by your name. He's called me I called you by your name. You are mine.
Mm-hmm.
This is the idea at the bottom of your existence.
Mm-hmm.
There is a kind of resonating reality and not a total alienation or something like this. But we have now, many people are not secular, right? So they have the same sense of nature, right? The voice of nature. When I'm in the forest or standing at the ocean, I feel part of an ultimate reality that actually breathes and lives and runs through me.
Mm-hmm.
And I can only find myself when I listen to this other. It's the same kind of, it's an excess of resonance between my inner and the outer, and it's the same in art. That's what we do with music. It connects you to life. You close your eyes and you hear something out there which is also inside you and somehow provides a kind of connection to the world as such. And this, I believe, is the reason why we really can develop a sense of being in resonance with the world as such. including the most alien places.
Yeah.
Okay.